I just started a petition on change.org that the portion of CBSE schools and Indian schools overall should change, and there should be a compulsion in environmental studies.
We have with us president of the Bamla Foundation, Asif Bamla, and we have Seher Bamla, who in her own words defies description, but is in charge of the youth wing of the Bamla Foundation.
Hello.
Thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having us.
So the Bamla Foundation, very cool organization, very focused on the environment. Asif, why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
Actually, if you ask me about the foundation, we've been fortunate. We completed 23 good years. But the environment endeavors began 13 years back, actually, when this issue, because in India, not many people used to talk on environment. There was no much awareness on that. So when the World Environment Day happened on the 5th of June, we said we should start off with some campaign. So we started the first ever time on the tree plantation drive.
Okay, this was 13 years ago.
Yeah, 13 years back. And when we celebrated that, we had about 150, 200 people on the Carter Road promenade and stuff like that. And people were like, what are you talking about, Environment Day? Is it a festival or what? I mean, people were not very aware because there was no much talk on global warming and so on and the other. But I always had that foresightedness that this is some issue that will pick up in years to come. And here we are, we're seeing that it's happening, you know.
Yeah, but what is that foresight about? Like, you're there 13 years ago. It's Environment Day. I mean, was there one? Did you see trash on the beach and you got inspired, or like, what was there a single moment that where it really clicked?
Oh yeah, of course. I actually, if you ask me, in Bandra we have a lot of mangroves, and we could see that there was in certain places in Mumbai city, the developers per se used to destroy the mangroves. At that time, the media was not so very active. It was not so receptive on environmental issue because the need and the seriousness towards the narrative of environment did not ever come out. So there was a small issue on the mangroves in a place in Chembur, I remember at that point in time, which happened where we got to know that there were some people who were doing a landfill there. So there is where I took on that issue, and then that got me connected to taking up this cause of the environment, which obviously involved the tree plantations, the rainwater harvesting. That time we didn't have the LED lights, but then after that we talked about solar paneling and so on and the other. So when it started off, the reciprocation was very lukewarm. It was like, oh man, why is he wasting our time? Mm-hmm. And what's he talking about, you know? So that point in time, there was no enthusiasm in the people, there was no encouragement in that. But then later on, as things went further, people say, hey, what's he talking about? Why, and what is he talking about? You know, and then the seriousness started slowly happening to an extent that in much parts of Bandra, Khar, and Santa Cruz, then we started approaching the residents' associations. The ALMs, that's the residents association heads. We started talking to them because we have those about residents associations of about 50 buildings, you know, with a committee there. Then we started talking to them. Then we talked about the garbage system, because then we got to know that there is a very major crisis. So when it came to, we started associating with the ALMs, with the resident associations. With the resident associations, the issue of segregations of garbage came to the fore when we started the propagation. So, you know, as you know, the mindset of the people, obviously the educated people in buildings, it's easier to convince. When you talk about the same thing to the slums and to the people, you know, in the chawls and stuff, they would not buy it. I mean, why are we going to do this? It's very painful.
So, but let me pick up on that point, because look, I am a foreigner in India, and I fully understand that and respect that, and I sort of try to keep my judgments to myself, right? Because I'm a guest. But I do notice that on the outside of a building, let's say, it could look very like, oh man, no one has cared for this building for a long time. But then you go on the inside and it's beautiful. And this idea of shared space and shared community, and that, you know, the sidewalks belong to all of us and all of that sort of thing. How do you overcome that hurdle to try to convince people to improve these shared spaces?
No, earlier this was not the case. You're seeing this now because you're now in India. We've seen a city of Mumbai where it was like there was a lot of trash. There used to be a lot of trash. There used to be a lot of garbage because there was no Mohims like the Swachhata Abhiyan. There was no campaigns like this. And the media too was not so very active, was not very receptive to the very idea of environment. You know, it's like the chalta hai, you know, attitude that the people of the city had, you know. So it was just happening and nobody is looking at that. Nobody's concerned about that. So we had to bring in people. We had to bind in volunteers. We had to involve the youngsters, the millennials in our area, in our constituency of Bandra, Khar, Santa Cruz, where the people, because we explained this to the millennials that, see, we have got this from our forefathers, and they were very conscious, and they've given us this environment in a very nice and a healthy and a congenial way. Will you get it in a similar way? We doubt that.
So you mentioned
you have to live with that. So you ensure that you have a greater concern and a larger outreach towards this cause of environment.
Sure, and you mentioned youth, obviously, and having Sahar here is a real privilege for us because, look, if I'm honest, I think your generation gets a bad rap, right? And I think your generation, and again, this is nothing personal, but I think your generation has a reputation for slacktivism, right?
Yes.
That I want to like something on Facebook and that's the end of it. So what do you say to people who come to you and you know, how do you encourage people to go out and actually do something?
To be very honest, it's like you mentioned, the slack tag and all of that. But everyone who I've spoken to about environment, and that, you know, I've been very open to everyone that, you know, I'm doing a mangrove cleanup every week or every 10 days. Please do come if you can come. And I think the young people now, be it Facebook, be it Instagram, we are very active on that. There is a lot of awareness because of that. You mentioned about liking, but, you know, them liking it also does make a difference, that at least they read the bloody post, right? Because only then they would like it. So, you know, it was not very tough for us to get youngsters on board because they themselves have realized that, you know, there is an environmental catastrophe all over the world, be it the recent events like Amazon rainforest. There's so many. There are tsunamis every month here and there. So they are very much aware. Social media has made it very easy for us to know what's happening in any part of the world. And they've been very open to come and work towards the environment. I still have so many people. Every day there's a message. Can I please intern in your foundation?
Huh.
Can we? And, you know, now I think that schools and colleges, for example, we have a lot of college students who want to come for beach cleanups because the colleges have given them hours that you have to complete 40 hours with an NGO.
Some kind of compulsory volunteer.
It is compulsory. So, you know, I just wish a few colleges are doing that. I just wish. In fact, I just started a petition on change.org that the portion of CBSE schools and Indian schools overall should change, and there should be a compulsion in environmental studies. I just launched it yesterday.
Oh, congratulations.
And we've had about 1,000 sign-ins, and it's growing. The numbers are growing very fast. I didn't check it right now.
Compulsory volunteerism, that sort of making volunteering part of the curriculum. Like, is that something
of course,
you would?
Of course. In fact, I have, to be very honest, I have made an appeal to the central environment minister. I remember visiting Delhi last time when I met the Honorable Prakash Javadekarji. I even met Mr. Babul Supriyo there. And we have, on behalf of my foundation, I've also spoken to a few activists here, have requested to have this as a subject in the curriculum. Like you have history, geography, mathematics, why not here? So similarly, I've even asked for a time with our environment minister in the state, Aditya Thackeray, where I want to represent a delegation of youngsters and of activists and heads of certain foundations and NGOs to request the state government to have this as part of, to have this as a period, to have that as a section, a curriculum, because and not from the secondary section. It should start from grade four. And as this a child grows, he should inherit and inhibit the seriousness of environment.
Sure.
And that will only happen when he grows that. Like when you have this as history, geography, mathematics. So if you have this environment as one subject, you have a teacher dedicated for that. You have to pass that test. Only then you pass. But I think when I spoke to the central ministry, they were very positive about this. I'm again going to follow up on that when I go to Delhi. Instead of, you know, talking so much on a lot of other issues, which are so much of wastages, you know, and stuff, let the children know the seriousness of composting.
Sure.
Let a child know that how important it is to not throw your trash outside the car when you're driving.
Do you think that's what it is? Is a lack of information that Sarah? Let me turn to you. This is closer to your generation.
Can I say something that change starts at your home?
Yeah.
You see your parents every day. I've seen my grand. So the only memory I have very few memories with my grandfather, my father's father. So, because he passed away when I was very young, but I still remember me and him planting a tree. Hmm. So the change basically starts at your home first and then school. So if you see your mother abusing, maybe the child immediately catches it. If you see your mother throwing something outside, the child will go and do the same thing. So, and if you see your mother composting your waste or, you know, doing recycling things, maybe like my mother uses the recycles all the plastic in the home. So if your mother is doing that, or if your father is taking some initiatives to have a positive environment in home, then the child automatically intakes it. And for example, one day he came home and he got so many metal bottles, metal and steel bottles, and he's like, I don't want any plastic at home.
Huh.
So that's how we don't have any plastic bottles at home.
Boy, and in the interest of full disclosure, we served both of you water in plastic bottles earlier. And I got to be honest, I thought about it, right? So like, oh my God, we're serving them in plastic water bottles.
No, I'm
sorry.
I didn't want to make an issue about it. I was thinking
about it. You
should have. I was thinking about it that, oh my God, he's serving us in plastic bottles. But luckily we had glasses, at least.
No, that was a faux pas on our part. But let's talk about plastic. You got very involved in this initiative to end the use of single-use plastics, right? Talk about that.
It was very nice. And I remember when the UN Environment announced that this year's theme is Beat Plastic Pollution. So we with our team of youngsters, millennials, senior, office bearers of the foundation, we discussed what do we do and how do we address this issue, something different. You know, people are tired of the gyan of lectures and, you know, interviews and stuff like that. So music was one factor that would be never have a greater outreach. Hmm. Because anything that has been an informatory song would be more effective. And then when I spoke to Singer Shan and I spoke to a few other influencers, and they said, why not? We're ready to do this. So I spoke to Mr. Swanand Kirkire, who's a national award winner. I said, can you, sir, will you write a song for us on plastic? So he was more than happy. It was Tick Tick Plastic.
Okay.
That became like an anthem, Touchwood. And it was so popular across the globe. I mean, I remember when I went to the to the United Nations in New York to, whenever we were called there, for the great work that we've done in the field of the plastic pollution campaign, when we were invited at the headquarters there, we saw that there were the song Tick Tick Plastic was converted into English.
Right.
With the same music, with the lyric change, and you had some children performing. The American children, you know, performing. Mm. The same thing, there were so many people from London who posted the same video with the same song. We had some British students, you know, from Europe also. So it kind of became a rave with millions of views to that. And the message was so outreach that in certain states in India, they've made this mandatory, this song, in the assembly hall.
It's a great achievement, and it's awesome that it worked. But I wonder about, you take a bit of a risk when you do that, though, right? I mean, and I'll turn to Sahar for this. It's the idea of authenticity, right? I can remember as a young man, you know, if I saw something on TV and I thought they were sort of like almost talking down to me, right? And so how do you, when you hear a song like this, Tick Tick Plastic, right? how do you ensure that that's like an authentic message to you and it's not someone preaching at you or condescending or it's lame, right?
So can I tell you something?
Please.
A song is always easier to remember than a lecture or a paragraph. It takes you 1 minute to learn a song. It took me 30 seconds to learn the song which he had created without it even being tuned into music.
Yeah,
like
that's a good
proper
point.
Music.
Yeah.
So the young people love rap. The second song what we created, Hawa Nere, and you know, suddenly the after the film Gully Boy, we realized that, you know, young millennials are loving rap music. So we were like, this time we have to create rap music because they love that. So, and it's so easy to pick up because the music helps to remember. And, you know, Indians love music. And if it has influences like Rajkumar Rao, Akshay Kumar.
Sure.
I personally am an ardent fan of Akshay Kumar. And that's why I'm like, Dad, you have to get him on board. And many more influencers. So, you know, the message goes out. And obviously, music is the best way to communicate to others. And I think lectures are the last way I would personally prefer knowing about.
So you both, and I'll turn to you again, Asif, you see a lot of value in having sort of celebrity endorsement. Because I think celebrities, you know, there are cynics who get cynical, you know.
There was some criticism also with me involving the celebrities, you know. I mean, I read one of the write-ups in some newspaper, but then I retorted back, why not? Celebrities are role models. If like you have a Karishma Kapoor, you know, saying and talking, I mean, there are millions of fans there. And Akshay Kumar, which we had, he posted on his Twitter, and we had that, like, the most viral video then on the World Environment Day, it was trending. So if I'm utilizing him and if they're doing pro bono, we should be thankful to them. Because we have a larger outreach, the message goes across clearer. If an Asif Mamla says something or if a Seher says something, maybe they may not listen to me. Maybe they say, okay, oh, come on, it's heavy bol raha, you know, like he's just saying for the sake of saying. But if Akshay Kumar is saying no, because they're role models, if they wear a hairband or a bandana, people copy them.
Sure.
If they wear, you know, the kind of pants, the suits, the shirts, people copy them. So when they do this, when they say to you via music that, oh, don't use plastics because it's non-biodegradable, you don't, you make sure that you do the tree plantations, the ill use of not utilizing public transportation. And, you know, in spite of that, also, we saw that there was a section which criticized even the film people that, okay, how much do you travel in public spaces? So anyway, that's all part of the work that we live in. But then when, with them saying, we had a Kapil Sharma, because he is very popular. So when he sang the song, it was so nice.
Yeah.
It was loved by people. And then when he shared it, it had millions of views. I mean, so why not involve them? We have the message also set across. We had the placards with all the messages. We showed the ill effects of usage of plastics. We showed the ill effects of air pollution via the song, not just the actors. The actors exhibiting your message, which goes across strongly to the people of the city, to the people of the country, is more important. And which is why globally both our campaigns have been very successful, and we were honored and we were you know, invited down there at the UN headquarters in New York. We got the award by the Government of India, by the Honorable Minister of Environment. It was unveiled. We are so proud that this campaign of Tick Tick Plastic, because India was a global host. So it was unveiled in New Delhi at the Vigyan Bhavan by the Honorable Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. In his presence, it was unveiled, obviously. So, I mean, it's a big honor and a privilege. I mean, what more than the Prime Minister in his auspicious presence, a campaign of that stature being unveiled, and we being part of the Ministry of Environment's campaign when India was the global host in the World Environment Day.
Well, let's talk about what's more. How do you follow that up, right? So you had this enormous success with the plastic. What do you do to top it, right? What's next? How do you follow that up?
You see, every year United Nations comes up with a theme. you see, beat plastic pollution, then beat air pollution. This time, the what is the?
It's on biodiversity. It's not finalized yet.
Okay.
But Molly, it's on biodiversity. So it obviously has to do with the lakes, with the waters, with everything, and with inculcates with environment. So on the basis of the theme that the UN gives, it's a global theme.
Sure.
So we make our campaigns, we evolve that campaign all around, and we utilize all that. Like now we are having this Green Marathon. You will see that the song that we prepared, we will be having that displayed there on that day, and we'll have the people, we'll have those bibs been given, those plantable seeds that will be given to all the marathon runners. Huh. We'll ensure that it is going to be a plastic-free marathon.
Sure. So do you think, and I want to leave politics out of it, but do you think the anti-single-use plastic initiative has been effective? Do you see a difference,
yes,
today versus, say, 2 years ago?
A very big difference. You go to a normal coffee shop, you go to Blue Tokai, you will not find anything of plastic. No plastic straws, no plastic spoons. It's everything paper, or, steel maybe if you're having it over there. So you don't have any plastic in most of the restaurants. Now, I just recently went out for dinner and I'm seeing steel straws at Five Stars. So they can't obviously serve in paper straws. So they've shifted to steel and metal and all of that.
Yeah.
So I have seen. So change can't happen overnight. And Mumbai is a big city, the fastest growing city. And you cannot, like, in one night eradicate all the single-use plastic. It takes a while.
Sure. And obviously it's I think it's something that everyone can kind of get behind, right? It's one of those things that's hard to say it's a bad thing, but then my own slacktivist self, like I mentioned earlier, I got a plastic bottle of water in my office. And so it is hard to get out of that habit, even though it's a very simple thing, because convenience is...
For example, just an example, when I'm out, and there are times when I'm not carrying a metal bottle or my personal water bottle, and I'm thirsty, so what do? I have to end up buying Bisleri. So yeah, it just... it's completely okay to be imperfectly vegan, imperfectly plastic-free, imperfectly sustainable, because small conscious changes are the most important, and it makes a big impact overall then.
So I don't have to be pure plastic, like pure veg.
You can try. I cannot, it gets tough, but I would always say that, try as much as you can.
Yeah.
Avoid using plastics, but
Yeah, you were gonna add to that. Just do what you can.
It's a movement, I would say. It's not so easy. I mean, if you ask me, you can't overrule plastic. It's also a big industry by itself. Mm. If you ask me,
sure.
It involves a lot of employment, and it involves a lot of things. But I'm happy and glad that that Aditya Thackerayji, who is also the environment minister, has taken it up head on. And I think our state, Maharashtra, was the first to declare the plastic ban. So kudos to the state and to him. And they've been taking head on. And of course, it's not going to be done overnight. It's taken months to reach here. It will still take months. But now people are aware now. Like you see for RA also. Hmm. It is such an important issue. People, of course, infrastructure is very, very important for the development of the state. We need metros, we need the coastliners. But again, if there was a viable solution, we're happy that, I would not make this a political narrative. But, it's not that the governments also don't want to be environment conscious. They too don't have a choice but to be environment conscious. Now we're coming up with these, electrical cars, if you see,
mm-hmm.
We're propagating the use of public transport. We are trying to, it is these small NGOs, these foundations with the government. If you make a good synergy, we can ensure that this gets successful. Because again, we can't just blame the government. This is not done that. What are you personally doing for that? How much have you walked the talk to address a technical issue? That is very important. And I think, obviously, yeah, there are still a lot of people, there are two sides to it, I've always said to everything. So, but still, there is, it's nice to see the Prime Minister also talking about cleanliness, about having clean toilets,
So, okay, so walking the talk. If someone's watching or listening right now and they want to get involved, they want to walk the talk with the Bomla Foundation, how do they get involved? What can they do?
Just an email.
Just an email?
Just an our contact numbers are available anywhere.
Okay, so Facebook, Instagram, web,
just
whatever.
Just a message. Anywhere. And it's very we're very approachable people. They all know, everyone knows that Bomla Foundation main head office is in Bandra. They just have to come and just meet anyone.
Okay.
They do come, and it's an ongoing activity. It's not that, okay, we do an optic event when it's required. But regular activism goes on. You don't have to highlight every activity that we like. We have our fortnightly campaigns for which we have an X number of students who participate, who come do the beach clean. They come do the mangrove campaign. They come for the, they volunteer and they participate in going to the societies, talking to the resident associations to compost the garbage. They go to the societies to meet them, to utilize, to change their electrical bulbs to LEDs. There is a group of sections who go to speak to societies on the rainwater harvesting. In fact, Bandra is one of the place which started the first biogas composting plant. And it's at the plush area of Pali Hill.
Do you feel like you're spreading yourself too thin? Like, I hear you talking, right? Single-use plastic, air pollution, electric cars, LED light bulbs, composting, rainwater harvesting. Like, at some point, it gets a little unwieldy, right? All these different issues. Are you able to sort of maintain all these little discrete projects?
If you ask me, 100% deliverables, if I say, I would be lying.
Huh.
But as I said, the movement is on. The seriousness is happening, will go on. The challenge is, of course, the uneducated lots and the slum pockets, the chawls, where, I mean, now even they are, you know, because they're also very very star centric. Akshay Kumar kar raha hai to main bhi karunga. It's like that.
Okay.
That okay, if you know, the Aditya Thakre is saying, though, even I will do it, you know. So you see, there are these statements that are there, you know. There is a narrative that is being created. So even there it is happening. But it takes time because you can't expect the same level of results to happen there. But I think it has gradually, because if you see the garbage that was picked up, very large few million tons of garbage that used to be picked up, and now that the garbage pickup, the waste has reduced to 50%. So that reduces the load of you know, of the city.
Sure.
At the end, our there's one team, as I discussed to you, which we're very working seriously on, is that having this technology in all wards of Mumbai, like we did in Bandra, so that you use your own garbage to enlighten your own vicinity, which is what the residents of Pali Hill did. Of course, we supported them. We had the residents there in the form of ALMs there who took up this head on. We had the Edge West ward officer, Mr. Ogare, who also had the inclination and the will to do it, to sanction the small piece of land from the Mahanagar Palika to where we installed this machinery which composts the garbage, and if we segregate the garbage, it transforms that same garbage to enlighten your vicinity. So it's zero garbage. So those huge trucks which used to go and pick your garbage, and which is there should be so much of carbon emissions because of that, that too has come into control now.
So all these little steps add up to something quite remarkable. And why don't we go ahead and leave it there? I think we're just out of time. But Asif Bomla, Sahar Bomla, Bomla Foundation, doing very interesting work in all kinds of environmental issues. They're on Instagram, Facebook, web, wherever. Twitter, you can find them, sign up, join them, do something. Little things add up to big things. That's ChartaCast for this week. Thank you to you both.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Such a wonderful time.